Bambi says very clearly that life is wondrous and beautiful and dangerous, and that in it, love is a song that never ends.
Bambi has a special place, I think, in everybody's heart.
It is such an artistic tour de force.
You don't see stories being told like that anymore that are so honest and genuine.
I can't think of anything more that through my years of being in the business that it'd be more of an achievement than that. And as I say, I've been in the business since I was 16 years old.
The story of Bambi is really the completion of a cycle. It's a circle of life. It's the original circle of life.
So that's what Bambi is about, life and struggle and death and rebirth.
And 52 years later, we see the same theme popping up in The Lion King.
We first started out on Lion King, it was a little bit of a coming-of-age story, and at times people would call it Bambi in Africa. In fact, we had trouble getting people to work on it for a while because we said, you know, it's really great. It's kind of Bambi in Africa with Hamlet and Elton John music. It's going to be great. And people would kind of shake their heads and walk out of the room. But the idea of that was right. Bambi, at its heart, is a coming-of-age story. It's the coming-of-age story. What happens when we lose our parents? What happens metaphorically when we're kicked out of the nest?
There really are a lot of parallels, and I think probably the animators were going back and seeking inspiration from Bambi.
And we completely borrowed from it in big heaping spoonfuls for Lion King, and happily so.
These stories, whether it's Bambi or Lion King, are just very difficult. You're not dealing with a straight dramatic story where good beats evil. It's just more involved when you deal with a circle of life or with growing up, with the change of the seasons, you know. You just have to find your own story within that. And that just takes time. And they were floundering way back on Bambi and going back and forth and liking the characters, but it didn't string up to a story that they were used to doing.
To the animators, to the artists who worked with him, Walt was probably the best story editor ever and worked very closely with the story artists.
He had a never-ending curiosity, and the story meetings for Bambi show Walt at his very curious best. He is asking questions about characters. What if we did this character here? What if we had Thumper say this rather than Mr. Hare?
The story of Bambi had so many possibilities, you could go off on a million tangents. I remember the one situation that Walt became involved with himself. He said, supposing we had Bambi step on an anthill, then we'd cut in the inside and we'd show that caused all sorts of damage to the ant civilization in there, and we spent weeks and weeks developing the ants, and then all of a sudden we all decided, you know, we're way off the story. This has nothing to do with the story of Bambi.
There really was a great deal that didn't make the final film. There were characters, the cute little squirrel that they had a lot of hope for, and the chipmunk.
We had a family of grasshoppers, and they get into a family squabble over this or that, and Bambi is watching all of this, and here's the big head of Bambi and the little grasshoppers. And what's that got to do with the story, you know? And this would go on many times.
For example, Thumper had a father who had a big role in the movie, which didn't really work out. They were just fine with just a mom.
And there are lots of story sketches for things involving bees and insects.
A wonderful sequence that Walt absolutely loved with a bee inside of Bambi's stomach, and how they would go to the ear to talk to the bee, and then they would go to Bambi's mouth to hear what he had to say, and gags. And ultimately, all of this didn't end up in the final film.
Well, I think a lot of the telling of any animated film, and particularly Bambi, from what I've read and heard from some of the people that were very closely involved with it, is that it was sculptural. And I know it was extremely long when they first put it together, you know, well over a couple of hours, and extremely complex. And to try to boil that all down like a fine sauce into something that is thick and rich and interesting and essential to tell that story.
In all the Disney films, there was an enormous amount of what some people would say superfluous work, but Walt saw as necessary, that was done and then cut. Bill Peet, one of the great story artists, once told me that if they had taken all the material they storyboarded for Pinocchio, the film would have lasted 2 days.
Walt wanted to show the hunter burned to death by the forest fire that he inadvertently started. And he fiddled around with this for a long time.
No, we were going to show a boot and the charcoal all around it. In fact, I made the drawing for it. The hunter's boot and the charcoal and the charred tree behind them. But I don't know, they just eliminated that type of thing. It didn't go over.
It is man. He is here again.
He wanted to have the impact, you know, of man coming into the forest and interrupting this nature. I mean, that's such an important part of this story, but you never saw it. And it made it so much more powerful.
Many people remember seeing the film in their childhood, as did I, and remember seeing the mother shot. But she was never seen shot. She died off camera. But the impact was such that people remembered actually having seen the mother die. Disney at one point had thought of actually showing that scene on screen, and there are storyboard sketches of the mother being shot. But eventually they decided that that was not something that they wanted to see on screen. In many ways, I think it's more powerful.
Mother, where are you? Lion King was a little bit of a different story. We felt like on that film we had to deal with a dead body, and Simba actually walks up to Mufasa and says, "Dad, Dad, come on, we have to go home."
I think we probably dealt with it in Lion King in a more 90s way. Simba had to go out and truly grieve over the death of his father. In Bambi, his mother's taken away, and he's never left to grieve or talk about it or deal with it.
I think it's equally sad and dramatic, but I think it was right for The Lion King, and I'm glad that they handled Bambi's mother's death that way, though, because I think it worked better for that film.
Your mother can't be with you anymore.
He sheds one tear, and he looks back. And as he looks back, I think what we as viewers see is the end of childhood.
I've often thought that Bambi is a film that a lot of contemporary filmmakers should study, because there are only about 1,000 words of dialogue in the entire film. And so you feel the characters breathing and thinking and reflecting and acting in ways that you often don't see today, where they're talking and making plot points so much, instead of allowing the visuals and the music to carry you through it.
I think that was the brilliance of what those guys did on that movie, is they were able to show, not in direct strokes on the screen, but show in impressions. It was more important to lead the audience to a certain point and then let the audience's imagination take over, much more powerful.
And that's why, to me, Bambi, even visually stunning, but it still looks very lean story-wise, really boiled down to its essence.
I would say that Walt had more to do with that than anybody else. A lot of people ask me, how much involvement did Walt have? Well, Walt had involvement from the very beginning to the last film that was put on the screen, the last little piece of film that was set on the screen.
To Disney, I think, there really wasn't a distinction between the story and the characters. The characters were the story, and vice versa.
What he tried to do in his pictures was to get definite personalities in the cartoon characters. And he said, without a definite personality, a character can't be believed.
I'm thumping. That's why they call me Thumper.
In Bambi, Walt wanted some poetry and some realism, and they just hadn't done that. So he took his top animators, the top draftsmen from the studio, and even then he wasn't sure whether they could pull it off. And he left them alone for a while to do some test animation, and I remember Frank Thomas did the scene where Bambi's chasing the butterfly, and I also remember Milt Kahl did the scene where Bambi's trying to jump over a fallen tree, and then flops on it, belly down.
You didn't hop far enough.
And those were the first scenes, the first pencil test that Walt saw.
And they showed their pieces of animation to Walt. Fear and trembling, because is it going to go or is it not going to go? These are the relationships that are going to make the movie.
And after the lights came up, Walt turned around and he had tears in his eyes. And he said, that's pure gold, boys. And that's what Bambi became.
Walt was always wanting to push the envelope of what animation could do. In a film like Bambi, he's clearly pushing naturalism to a degree that no one has matched since in animation, and it's unlikely anyone ever will.
I think Walt picked his team for Bambi very, very carefully because he knew that this animation was going to be more difficult. It's not the cartoony type of animation that the animators had done, that there would be a lot of study involved, years of studying. So he picked Eric Larson and Frank Thomas and Ollie Johnson and Milt Kahl as his key animators, and that was a good choice because they just dealt with those assignments really, really well.
They knew that what they were doing was not going to be easy. They knew that they didn't know what they were doing in the best sense of the word, and so they brought in the best teachers from Chouinard Art Institute at the time and the best lecturers.
Walt was convinced that with a little training that we could put a lot of emotion and feeling into the animals without making them old cartoon type of animals, but realistic and convincing. I think he was right, but I don't think most of the men themselves at the studio thought so.
It was a big risk to do something like Bambi, and it was asking a lot from the animators to animate those kind of characters. Because when you look at the animals, and especially the deer that are in Snow White, they are so cartoony and simple and have really bodies like flour sacks.
It's a great exercise to put those back to back just a couple years before to look at Snow White and then look at Bambi and see the care and attention to detail that's given to the anatomy and the locomotion of the animals. And it's all done with a pencil on a piece of paper, and it's pretty amazing.
So this is one of the original model sheets that was actually used in the early 40s. This one has a date on it, 23rd of May, 1940, when this was approved. And you can just see by the variety of poses and the thorough study of anatomy in these that this was something completely new.
We found ourselves in a place where they had stacked it with cages with all of the animals that would be in the picture, the skunks and rabbits.
We had live deer running around the studio, so they became somewhat pets.
And then they brought Rico LeBrun, who was a great artist for anatomy, and they had anatomy classes.
Just like you'd have a life class for a human figure, we had a life class of deer. But these were the structural things that we worked over and over, and he just drilled us and drilled us and drilled us to understand what the anatomy, what the bone structure of these little guys were.
They approached Bambi the way Leonardo da Vinci approached human beings. And that's why the animation is suddenly different. It isn't some artist remembering deer that he saw on a farm when he was a kid. It's some artist remembering the deer that he studied yesterday with a pad in his hand.
There was a story sketch artist. His name was Bernard Garbert. And he did beautiful drawings of deer. But Bernard Garbert had a very nice, simple way of getting a fluid feel into the drawings, and they started to move. They still didn't look like deer that could talk and would have human expressions, but he really simplified the deer body. And then Mark Davis came in, and he was able to really put human expressions and human attitudes onto a deer body. So that was really a breakthrough.
When Mark Davis was working on the designs, he studied expressions, particularly in babies, and applied some of that knowledge to the designs of the animals.
I was going through a book on child psychology, and these are all based, every face is based on the expression of human babies interpreted into the head of a young deer.
And then the great Milt Kahl came in and looked at everything and then boiled it down to something that would be right for the film, that could be animated, and that would just feel right.
We came as close as we figured we possibly could to the real deer and still be able to articulate for dialogue and get and have a full range of expressions.
Go on, say hello.
low.
I think that influenced animators, you know, for decades, up to, even to the today, because when you have a story that you want to portray a world and make that world very, very believable, you know, and that world is a natural world, inevitably you always look at Bambi as one of the great examples of that.
When you look at, say, Ollie Johnston's animation of Thumper.
It's delicious. Why don't you try some?
I did stuff for Thumper. Tells him, no, no, don't eat that green stuff.
Just eat the blossoms. That's the good stuff.
Thumper, what did your father tell you?
About what?
He is so much like a little boy who's gotten his hand caught in the cookie jar, and it's in the body language and the expressions.
Kind of wobbly, isn't he?
Thumper.
Well, he is.
Just because there are a bunch of pencil drawings going through these routines and giving these performances, to me, that was real.
In Frank Thomas's animation, he's very much known for his sincerity.
Frank Thomas came up with this great ice skating sequence with Thumper, all these wonderful gestures, this cocky little kid, when he raises his chest and wiggles his butt and says,
"Watch what I can do!"
At the time, I was trying to learn how to ice skate. And every time I'd come on a rink like this, you know, and go along very nervously, step by step, here'd be these other guys on their hockey skates. Vroom, vroom, oh, boy. I said, that's the way Thumper ought to be, you know, and Bambi ought to be like me, going along here. So it was fun to animate the thing, particularly the Thumper part, getting him to act the way I always wished I could on skates.
You're seeing a rabbit, anatomically beautifully drawn rabbit, and you're seeing a caricature of probably a kid that you knew next door. And you relate to it because of that. You relate to it because it looks like the next door neighbor or like your son or daughter or niece or nephew.
Power! No, 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 no. That's not a flower!
He can call me a flower if he wants to.
They worked out the essence of Disney animation on Bambi that's continued to this day, which is animals who are caricatures of human beings and at the same time move and behave like animals. People got intoxicated with the vision of what animation could be, and the art of animation never was the same again.
Well, the voices in Bambi are not famous voices. They were not child actors that had been in films.
Say bird.
But they're perfect. They're absolutely perfect.
Bird!
And that's what you're looking for as an animator. You don't really need a star. You don't really need somebody with a big name.
I was 4 to 6 years old when we did the voice of Thumper. My father was in the movie industry and heard that they were auditioning, and there were some 30 children who were at the voice recordings.
Frank Thomas and Ollie Johnston told me the story of being in the recording session where they brought all the kids in, and they were, you know, having the kids all do, oh, did he, the young prince fall down, did he fall down? And there's a, did the young prince fall down?
Did the young prince fall down?
And the one who was leading the recording session was saying, oh, you know, get that kid to the back. You know, he can't act. But Frank and Ollie were sitting in the back of the recording booth. And they said, they were just like, no, 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 no. Let that bring that kid forward.
They heard my voice and decided it was perfect for the rabbit. And apparently that's what they said.
He doesn't walk very good, does he?
So that character was born out of that recording session.
There was a thing going on. The casting director didn't like Peter Bain because couldn't apparently finish long sentences.
You had to feed him a few words at a time, you know. See, that's the only way you could do it. But you couldn't put two of them together. And there was one line where he forgot his line and he said,
if you can't say something nice.
And then he had to think, you know. And then he could spiel out the rest of it up.
Don't say nothing at all.
What came out in the end was so different and charming, and unusual.
Come on, it's all right.
They found this innocence and sincerity in this kid to give you that performance and then to be able to have the animation to go along with it.
Some fun, huh, Bambi?
As far as it being a distinctive voice, the people do say that, and I think maybe because it was authentic.
Come on, you can do it.
I was an exuberant kid, and I think it came out and made a very good match for the particular needs of the movie.
As long as the voice goes along with the personality and the character and looks like, and or it sounds like, that voice is coming out of that drawing, that's what really matters.
I think I better go home now.
I think these Bambi voices are perfect.
My original hiring from Mr. Disney was to be the model. The first experience that I recall doing any work there, where I sat on a stool, and some nice people, very gentle, would say, "We want you to look up like you're afraid, look like you're surprised." And we had a great time.
Hello, Bambi.
I suppose my mother brought me to audition, and it was after I was in Gone with the Wind. So it would be age 5. I certainly was not professional.
I said hello.
I think Mr. Disney had an extra sense of, let's have real children in, doing real children things, because these are young children animals.
It was very real to me doing it, because I was being myself.
He's kind of bashful, isn't he, Mama?
If I hear that voice, that is a part of my childhood. And it's sweet. It's just very, it's touching.
One of my embarrassments as an adult is that I didn't have the courage to tell close, trusted friends, 25 years in the Marine Corps, that I participated and was one of the voices of the wonderful work of Mr. Disney, Bambi. It was because I was in a part of the Marine Corps that was the Marine Corps. And if the troops I was leading as a battalion commander, if they found out that I was part of Bambi and I picked up the nickname Bambi, I would have been history.
Pretty flower.
If you think about it, I was in Gone with the Wind and I was in Bambi at the age of 5 when I peaked. So, you know, what are the chances of being in 2 classics and never doing another thing? Absolutely amazing. Absolutely amazing.
In the case of Bambi, I think it was a brilliant casting thing to stumble across, you know, people that could do those voices, and they really were tenacious about it. And you find somebody like, you know, the Thumper voice, which is one in a million, and suggest that character. Yeah, he's a cute kid, but to be able to then take that voice and turn that into a piece of animation that's now become very memorable for all of us is really pretty special.
Look, he's trying to get up.
Well, it is funny to be associated with a bunny, but I think the character of Thumper, as it came through in the movie, is something I've always been pleased and proud that I was a part of that.
What you gonna call him?
I think I'll call him Bambi.
Bambi. Yep, I guess I'll do all right.
I had great admiration for this film. I remembered the sensitivity of what the coaches gave me when I was doing the voice. And films like Bambi allow the children to be children before they got biased and hammered with all the things that we experience in adulthood. And I respect that deeply.
It's just humbling. And how did I get so lucky? And I feel a little guilty accepting praise or oh my gosh, you did this, because what did I really have to do with it? But I am never going to diminish the great good fortune. It's amazing that I would have been in Bambi. It's amazing to me, and I'm very thankful.
If you talk to any background artist from any of the current generation of animated filmmakers, they'll ask them for their favorite movies. Bambi is going to be at the top of the list because of its painterly style.
The talent is awe-inspiring on all levels. I don't ever think up until that time they had done backgrounds like that. To have the guts to say we're not going to draw every leaf, we're going to do impressionism.
The idea was not just to kind of depict nature, but kind of go for a feeling that you get when you're in the woods.
When they were going to work on Bambi, Walt sent a team of photographers up to Maine, to the forest, and they made studies of the forest and the forest creatures.
And he came back with hundreds of pictures. And we were very much enthused with that type of thing, but it didn't work. We were doing too much detail.
And then after Walt looked at millions of leaves and trees, he was getting a little discouraged about how we're going to do this thing.
Each of the great Disney features have certain artists who would kind of set the tone or the keynote them in a way. And on Bambi, it was Tyrus Wong. He was a Chinese artist who came to America as a young man, as a boy actually, had studied art here, and he brought a Chinese aesthetic to his paintings.
Because I got married, Chinese family, when you get married, well, you have to support wife, right? So I said, well, I talked to my wife.
And so she asked him, said, why don't you go over to Disney studio and ask for a job? So they took him in and put him to work as an in-betweener and training to eventually become an animator.
Well, in-betweening, you're doing the drawings in between the main drawings, and it becomes very repetitive, and it can drive you crazy sometimes.
And boy, when I did that, when I get home, my eyes would feel like it really drop out of the socket. It's constantly flipping the paper, and I think I was there for about a month or so. So I finally found out that they were doing Bambi. I'm mainly a landscape painter anyway. So I work up the tiny sketches and bring it in and show it to them. Tom Cotterick. He said, gee, what are you doing? I said, well, I'm doing in-betweening. He said, maybe we put you in the wrong department.
Walt had a wonderful way of organizing and finding talent, and a typical Walt Disney discovery by seeing his work. It was sometime later that we realized he had this marvelous color sense, and that you'll see in the film itself.
So that's how eventually the style of Bambi came about. Tyrus Wong just needed a job in the big depression.
What Tyrus Wong brought to the art direction is just absolutely stunning. And he had thousands of small scale and large scale sketches that were very lyrical and had that poetry that Walt wanted.
When you take a step back from the story, which is hard to do with Bambi, but if you can, take a step back, turn off the sound, and just start looking at every image, you will be so stunned at how every scene is like this exquisite painting of nature. Not realistic, in fact, very stylized, but it represents that feeling of being in the forest.
It's the forest of your dreams and the forest you experience rather than the forest you actually see. And that's very much the aesthetic in Chinese landscape paintings.
At that time, Chinese influence, it just natural, came natural with me.
We realized the simplicity of Tai's backgrounds. You could still get all the color you needed with simple forms. Then the main characters would show up beautifully in front of that.
I think Walt was fortunate to have Tyrus Wong working there to come up with that concept.
Although he's a very modest man and doesn't realize it, even today there are young artists who still look to him as one of the great talents ever to work in that area of design.
It was transcendent, it really was. It's just absolutely beautiful and very unlike anything that we had ever done before at this studio.
All of us, when we start out, we look to, you know, what the masters did, and that's what, you know, they're a bunch of masters, they paved the way. And so to see what Tyrus has done, and it's giving you inspiration to kind of branch out yourself and explore new areas that haven't been done before, because that's what these guys did.
How much do you respect a stroke of brilliance? And I think that Tyrus was one of these painters that kind of come in and left his mark.
It never dawned on me that that's an influence.
you know.
Walt Disney had this thing he called the plausible impossible. He said our movies don't have to be real, they have to be plausible. And yet what we're creating on the screen is completely impossible. And Bambi's a great example of that. Deer don't talk, and skunks and bunnies don't talk, but they do in Bambi. And this world seems very real and very alive. Big, big part of that is the backgrounds, the atmosphere, and the visual effects that go on when you're seeing the film.
You've got flowers growing, you've got leaves blowing in the fall, and then you've got the forest fire. All of these things that happen out in the natural wild, you have to recreate those.
And what people don't realize sometimes is all that had to be drawn. All that had to be drawn frame by frame in exactly the same way that the characters had to be drawn.
There was also a lot of development going on in the camera department and doing optical effects.
Walt was always had experiments going on with smaller films that he could adapt to the larger films. On the old mill painting, they established the effects of the ripple glass.
Ripple glass was optically ground glass that had a pattern to it, and when you move that under the lens over artwork, you got this ripple water effect. You created these beautiful moments in water. They also used ripple glass for the fire, that really created some heat distortions.
The effects were so groundbreaking. When there's snow, you couldn't just animate snowflakes by just hand draw them. They did all kinds of experimentations by dropping cornflakes and filming that in slow motion and then bleaching it or just making it look white. And that was the right effect, sort of these cornflakes falling.
Time magazine talked about a Disney artist being arrested for lying on his back on the sidewalk, staring up and not wanting to be moved. I don't know if that really happened or not, but the point is it could have really happened if he was a special effects guy, because what he wanted to know was, what do the raindrops look like as they come toward your eyeballs? Because we want to put that into the Little April Showers number.
They filmed live action rain on a soundstage against a black background, and we're still using those film elements 60 years later. We used them in Little Mermaid, we used them in Pocahontas, in Lion King. And so there's a great sense of history and of paying homage to those early visual effects artists.
Walt and his team were always looking for ways of creating dimension in their work. And you really saw this in a big way in the build-up to Snow White. They knew that to sustain a feature-length animated film, it couldn't just be a cartoon that was long. It had to actually have production values. And one of the things they tested in a short called The Old Mill was the multiplane camera. So it was taking a background painting, and instead of painting it on one piece of paper, they would break it off on several sheets of glass, maybe four or five deep. And so if you had a farm on a country road, you would see a piece of the fence and the mailbox, and on the next piece of glass, you would see a piece of the road, and then on the back, you'd see the barn. And when you put a camera there and shot through all those layers of glass, you would get a really interesting feeling of perspective.
If you look at that multiplane camera shot, it takes you deep into the forest in the very first sequence of Bambi. The main thing it did was it gave the illusion of depth. And Walt wanted you to see depth because that's the way he saw that forest.
There were shots that are just vistas that have so much depth, you feel like you can just reach in and walk into that frame.
It's great, and it's all part of the storytelling. All those effects, just like every other aspect of the film, the painting and the design and the animation, it's all that work that they put into that that really made it pay off and make it such a great piece of art.
Well, the result is, it's up there on the screen. You can see it, and you've been there before. You know the whole forest.
We look at Bambi and say, wow, that has all the romance of a beautiful old handwritten letter or a beautiful hand-done painting. And we see that. We see the humanity up on the screen in every way, and I think that's part of the reason we react to it the way we do.
Isn't it amazing how subtle the music is in Bambi?
You don't really realize how swept away and enveloped you are by it. Through that music, you actually enter the forest.
It's making nature itself a character and bringing it to the screen in a way that certainly no one had done in animation before, and I think very few people had even attempted to do in live action.
And I realized that it was a pastoral symphony, just as Beethoven wrote, which was something that was in their minds at the time, clearly, because Fantasia was being completed at the same time, the pastoral symphony for children. Every cell that you see, every background, is completely brilliant work. But the impact of a motion picture, the succession of images of film, is glued together by the music. This is why music has always been part of movies.
There's a beautiful scene where Bambi has fallen down and all the rabbits go, "Get up, Bambi, get up.
Come on, get up.
Come on,
get up, Bambi. Get up."
And he has a way of getting up with doing one leg first and then the other leg catches up. It's just gorgeous. And that's all done to music. And that unity between music and animation is just fantastic.
That Disney cared so much about music cannot ever be overstated. Music was as important to him as anything that happened on the screen.
I think Walt realized that music was going to have to play an exceptional role in Bambi because the dialogue is so minimal. He would very often make the artists storyboard sequences in mime, and then only at the very last minute could they add what dialogue they absolutely couldn't do without.
From the beginning of Bambi to the end of Bambi, there's almost not a moment without music. There are two 18-second silences. One is when Bambi's mother says,
"Man was in the forest."
And this complete silence. I mean, 18 seconds is a really long time. And the other time is after Bambi's mother dies. These moments of silence are powerful because they're surrounded by wall-to-wall music.
There were two Academy Award nominations for Bambi. Both had to do with music. The song Love is a Song was nominated and sung behind the credits by Donald Novus, who was a very important singer at that time. And also the scoring was nominated as well.
The main composer behind Bambi is Frank Churchill. His music, his themes, his motifs were taken and then arranged into the final score. And Edward Plum did what you would call secondary scoring. Plum was a musical director for Fantasia, so when you hear some of his music in the film, it definitely has a more classical sound than Frank Churchill. Frank Churchill had had a huge success with Snow White. He had written all the songs and a lot of the underscoring, and those were songs that were on the hit parade. They were extremely popular. He wrote Who's Afraid of the Big Bad Wolf from The Three Little Pigs. His melodies were very simple, very catchy, and very memorable. He was relatively untrained, but an intuitive, natural musician who could come up with endless melodies.
His on-the-job training was to play music for silent movies. What a lot of people don't realize is that when silent films were being filmed, the actors and actresses were being put into the mood of the scene by somebody playing a piano. And Frank Churchill used to improvise the moods for these different scenes. That experience made him the ideal person to set the mood, as it were, for a skunk named Flower or a little bunny named Thumper or for Bambi.
I remember clearly how we were involved with the first rainstorm, and we wanted a raindrop song that would show Bambi experiencing the first raindrops. And we didn't have anything at the time, and finally Frank Churchill came in one day. Frank was quite a character. He shuffled down the hall, and he always wore his hat, and he sat down at the piano wearing his hat, crossed his legs over, and he puts one foot on the pedal, reaches in his pocket, takes out a little script, puts it down on the piano, and then starts to tinkle off on the piano there this little raindrop song. And it was so charming, it was unbelievable.
Somebody could take a chord and and nothing, but Frank Churchill could take it and... It's the creative genius that Frank Churchill had.
The way he makes us feel nature and yet write simple tunes of all different kinds of qualities is really quite interesting in Bambi. Ed Plum, who was the other composer, is said to have studied with Johann Strauss, which is very believable. There's no question that between the two of them, they create a world of the past, maybe when we might have been closer to nature.
And it's really amazing that the score is so unified, because you have the very sophisticated work of Edward Plum, with its echo of Stravinsky and Ravel, and then you have the very childlike melodies of Frank Churchill. You have the main title, which is the Love is a Song theme, which is sung by a tenor, and then you have the music for the forest waking up, and it's just a very simple theme, but very lovely. The man motif, which was just a simple three-note progression down here. And here's a melody that Edward Plum composed for the autumn sequence. Almost every measure of that is a different chord. The whole film just has emotional power to it, generated by the musical score.
Bambi is the first feature film of any kind where songs were sung off camera, not by the characters themselves, in order to pass on the narrative.
When you have less than 1,000 words of dialogue in a film, your ear really hungers for sound. 40-voice choir, 4 individual artists singing beautiful, lovely, melodic tunes. The feast of music with this broad, ranging orchestral score.
When you look at Bambi today, you're aware of Walt Disney's seriousness of his purpose in entertaining. What a high level he set. We now are the recipients of this tremendous vision, and we just now almost take it for granted. If you look at it really carefully and listen to it really carefully, you're amazed at how far they push the envelope. I don't think Bambi would be Bambi without its music.
Of all the deer in the forest, not one has lived half so long. That's why he's known as the Great Prince of the Forest.
Bambi the book was published in 1928 and written by an Austrian author named Felix Salten. And actually, he did 6 books, 3 of which were turned into Disney films, Bambi, Perry, and then The Hound of Florence, which became The Shaggy Dog.
How does a novel written by a man who works in an insurance office in Vienna, who's bored out of his mind and starts to write the story Bambi, how that gets to Disney is already an amazing story. And it involves, of course, World War II. It involves everything that's going on at that period.
Felix Salten's book came to Walt's attention by a fellow named Sidney Franklin in 1935. He was a producer and director of live-action films at MGM, and his films always had a great understanding of character and story and a lot of heart, films like Goodbye, Mr. Chips, Mrs. Miniver. Salten's book was a natural for Sidney Franklin. He optioned the film rights in 1933, and for a couple of years he played around with making an actual live-action version of the film.
Sidney Franklin liked the book very much, but he didn't think that it was possible to do a picture that had that much emotion with the animals.
So he realized the true medium for making Bambi would be animation, and my gosh, who better in the world to do this than Walt Disney, the king of animation? So he approached Walt Disney with the book.
And the book itself had a lot of poetry and beautiful scenes in it, and dramatic scenes. And when Walt heard about it and read the book and saw what the possibilities were, he became extremely enthused about it.
I think Walt was always somebody who, he was a nature guy. He liked nature, he liked the seasons, and he liked the outdoors.
And so from that aspect, I think it was very close to his heart and one of the reasons why he poured so much of himself into it.
This is the kind of film he wanted to make, and it would be in advance. And so he risked everything. He was such a successful guy after Snow White, and he puts it all on the line again immediately. I mean, who does that now? It's incredible. Incredible.
In the early 1940s, they had already done The Impossible. They made Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs. They had done the next Impossible, which is that they had made Fantasia and Pinocchio. The last thing they really needed to do was, like, outdo themselves, and yet they decided to push the envelope one bit forward.
That endless experimenting was very much Walt's personal style.
I always refer to the making of Snow White, where everybody was saying, you can't make a feature with animated cartoons. It's not going to work. A lot of people thought that, including animators. And when Walt came in and told the animators, he said, you know, my idea is...
Dwarfs' names fit their personalities.
This guy here, maybe he is grumpy. He'll be different. He's not just another old little old man. He'll be a grumpy little old man. And then this man here, we'll make him sneezy, maybe. He'll sneeze.
This little fellow is bashful. He's secretly in love with Snow White.
By the time Walt got through telling him about his characters, everybody's saying, yeah, I think we can do that. Yeah. Well, that's how Walt was.
That kind of restless creativity that was never satisfied, that was always looking a couple of films ahead, I think is very clear in Bambi. And when you see the process by which it was developed, he's still experimenting and exploring and looking for, okay, where can we take this?
This great work of art, Bambi, came from the most chaotic time in the Disney studios. Really, the time that Bambi was in production from about 1936 to its release in 1942 was a roller coaster ride for Disney in the studios. It was a very tumultuous time.
In 1939, the Nazis marched into Poland. The world was plunged into war. Disney lost their European market. Pinocchio did not make a profit.
It was somewhat of a scary time. I mean, there was a feeling of unease in Europe at that time, and financially things were not all that rosy.
And Walt ended up in debt to the Bank of America.
And he called over Mr. Giannini from the Bank of America, and he came over with his entourage of all the men in the dark suits, and they were all going to stand there and listen to Walt try to sell them on the idea of getting more money into this picture. And Walt started to tell the story. And I've never seen a man sell a story or an idea better than Walt. Walt was the greatest actor at that time. And I saw Mr. Giannini and his entourage watching all of this, enthralled with Walt and the story of Bambi. We got the money. Walt was the best salesman I'd ever seen. In fact, if I had the money, I would have invested in it.
And along about 1940, you have some labor unrest at the Disney studio. It was really a time of union organization, especially in the studios in Hollywood. And with the financial problems that Disney was facing, there were rumors rampant at the studio about potential layoffs. The Screen Cartoonists Guild was run by a real tough, hardline laborer named Herbert Sorrell, whose very name would bring most studio bosses to their knees. He went in with a meeting with Walt and said, you need to sign with me. Walt refused. He said, no, it's not my place to do that. I want to put this to a vote. I'll go with whatever my boys want. Sorrell had lost before on a vote, and I think he realized that he didn't have a majority of the artists. And he threatened Walt with a strike. Walt was adamant. He was not going to sign with Sorrell's union unless the boys voted it. Sorrell left, and the situation worsened. Tempers flared until on May 29th, 1941, Walt was surprised the studio had come under a strike.
Well, Bambi was still in the early stages of production and pre-production during the strike, but that was such a watershed in the history of the Disney studio and the history of animation that its impact was felt and still echoes down the decades. I don't know that any of the key artists on Bambi went out on the strike. They were in a a different area physically.
We hardly knew that the strike was happening, and I naively just came into work every day.
My sympathy at that time was very much with Walt when he realized who he was, the origin of his pictures, and to have it taken away from him by the strikes.
And then finally, they brought in a government mediator, and the government mediator settled the strike if Walt would take two strikers for every person that didn't go out on strike. And that's what happened to the studio.
Then the Japanese bombed Pearl Harbor. We got in the Second World War.
The war had an enormous impact on the Disney studio.
The war turned our studio into a military reservation. All our facilities were devoted to making films for the war effort.
And actually, you know, the studio was taken over. So he survived that way.
By the time of Bambi's release in August of 1942, the world had been at war for almost 3 years, and the United States had been at war for 9 to 10 months.
I find it maybe an overlaying emotion to the picture, but the idea that it opened in August of 1942 during the war in London. It's the world premiere was in London, right in the middle of it all.
I mean, Bambi was much realer and intense dramatically than audiences might have been expecting from an animated film.
Well, as a matter of fact, Bambi didn't make a profit on the first release.
Pinocchio, Fantasia, and Bambi all lost money initially. Since then, of course, they've gone on to reap millions. But it took those films a while to be recognized for what they were by the general public.
Walt should have been rewarded tremendously for Fantasia, for Dumbo, for Bambi, but the public was just simply onto global domination.
But Walt was the eternal optimist. Now, even though we have the deer facing trials and tribulations and the loss of his mother, ultimately everything ends up all right. And that was sort of what was going on at the studio, is here Walt was going through all the trials and tribulations of the strike, the financial problems and the war. And I think internally he was an optimist. He felt that everything would turn out right. And that was Bambi.
Bambi's a movie with great poetry and elegance and artistic integrity. But at its core is something very emotional. And of course, that's Disney storytelling at its best.
This world could use some of the messages, that little beautiful story of Bambi.
A film like Bambi will never get old. It's timeless.
It really stands alone as one of, you know, the great motion pictures ever made.
People talk about the philosophies, the art value, the animation, and the styling of that picture as being the epitome of the art of animation. Glad to have been part of that.
Hello, I'm Patrick Stewart. And I'm delighted to say that I recently became a member of the Disney Pantheon of Voice Talent by portraying Bambi's father, the great Prince of the Forest, in the studio's upcoming release of Bambi 2. Over 60 years has passed since Bambi first charmed the world, and it continues to do so to this day. It's a timeless classic, but unfortunately, time has taken its toll on the original film elements. Thanks to the Walt Disney Company's commitment to preserving its timeless treasures for future generations, I'm happy to tell you about the remarkable, groundbreaking restoration that has taken place on Walt's masterpiece, specifically for this platinum DVD release. Working from the original monaural music tracks, Bambi has been brought into this millennium with a newly created 5.1 Disney-enhanced home theater mix. It gives a vividness and scope to this magnificent score that is unlike anything you've heard before. The end product is the most spectacular looking and sounding presentation of Bambi ever.
Bambi and some of our other classic films, the actual original nitrate negatives are being stored at the Library of Congress film vaults.
Back in the late 50s, early 60s, the library decided to get into film preservation because a lot of the older films were just being abandoned. The film itself has basically the same chemical composition as gunpowder. Once it starts to break down, work has to be done quickly because one day it's fine, 6 months it's a can of powder.
After many years of rest in the Library of Congress, the original negative for Bambi was pulled from the vaults and brought home to Los Angeles to undergo a restoration using today's cutting-edge digital technology.
All film stock of this era decays and becomes unstable, and not to be too dramatic about it, but it quite literally will die. Now, both the digital and film backups that we're going to do on this restoration will ensure its life for many, many, many generations. But this is really now the time to do it while the negative is still in very good shape.
When we start a movie like this, the first thing we do is we inspect the film very, very thoroughly, frame by frame, check the whole thing to make sure there's no torn sprocket holes or rips in the film or bad splices. We use a clean room primarily to make sure there is no dust in the environment, no dirt.
The film is scanned frame by frame at a very high resolution.
Those films were shot on successive exposure film, and so there's three color records for every frame. So each one of those color records is scanned.
These digital scans are then put through an automated cleaning process using software to remove dirt and other imperfections.
Well, this is quite an occasion.
Finally, the film is scrutinized frame by frame by an operator who removes any final imperfections that may still exist on the image.
So we're able to go in there and clean up this movie so it's absolutely pristine and still retain the artistic integrity of the movie.
Party.
Once the film is completely cleaned, technicians begin an extensive color correction process. Their goal is to restore the outstanding artwork to its intended splendor and vibrancy.
My responsibility is to maintain the look that the artists who originally made the film intended. The backgrounds in Bambi are each one of them a piece of fine art on their own merits.
Referencing the original artwork for the film stored at the Animation Research Library, they painstakingly execute subtle adjustments to the hues, always conscious not to exaggerate the color tones or compromise the integrity of the original film.
The quality of the artwork that was produced for Bambi was pretty phenomenal. So as part of our research, when we're restoring Bambi, we look at the artwork very closely and understand the textures and the color so that when we're doing our restoration, we can try to make sure we stay as true to that as possible.
The result is an image free from dust, dirt, and scratches with brilliant colors and pristine visual quality. So stunning, even Walt himself would be amazed.
These films are treasures. They represent different periods in our history.
Some fun! Huh, Bambi?
Through his endearing films and rich imagination, Walt Disney was able to provide warmth, humor, and entertainment to audiences past and present. Now, thanks to today's remarkable technology, we are not only able to preserve this precious classic for future generations, we have been able to enhance its sound and picture to new heights beyond the expectations of the original filmmakers. I think Walt would approve.
The 1940s were one of the most pivotal decades of the 20th century. In 1942, the world was at war, fighting by land, by sea, and by air. Franklin Delano Roosevelt was in the White House. Winston Churchill was Prime Minister of England. And Joseph Stalin, leader of the USSR, was Time Magazine's Man of the Year. Those left behind did their best to keep up morale. The USO was formed to lift the spirits of military personnel worldwide. Benny Goodman was leading the band, and Walt Disney was changing the face of family entertainment. Disney Studios had been working on Bambi for 6 years and was eagerly anticipating its release. But with World War II raging overseas, the military called upon Walt to use his facilities to make educational, training, and patriotic films.
Walt Disney orders his famous cartoon characters into battle dress. They're in popular demand as emblems for the armed forces.
Walt complied and halted all commercial production, except for Bambi.
Bambi!
Did you know that in 1942, a house in the United States could be bought for less than $7,000? A car cost a little over $1,000. You could buy a movie ticket for about a quarter, ice cream for 15 cents, and soda pop was only a nickel. While big shoulders, elegant suits, and hooded coats were in style, and elaborate hats were all the rage, many women in the U.S. and abroad took to wearing slacks in the workplace. In baseball, the St. Louis Cardinals beat the New York Yankees 4-1 in the World Series. And in boxing, Joe Louis KO'd Buddy Bear to retain his title as heavyweight champ. Television was still in its infancy, so families gathered around their radios for news and entertainment. Couples were jitterbugging on the dance floor, and popular tunes leaned toward the romantic and sentimental. Bing Crosby's recording of White Christmas, heard in the hit film Holiday Inn, was number one for 11 weeks. The lights on Broadway were dimmed, but not extinguished that year. George Gershwin's Porgy and Bess, Irving Berlin's This Is the Army, and Thornton Wilder's Pulitzer Prize-winning play, The Skin of Our Teeth, commanded standing ovations. Movies were as popular as ever, offering escapism, inspiration, and romance. Mrs. Miniver, starring Greer Garson, was the highest-grossing picture of the year and went on to win 6 Academy Awards, including Best Picture, Best Director, and Best Actress.
Greer Garson wins the award for her unforgettable Mrs. Miniver.
Disney released 19 animated shorts starring Mickey Mouse, Donald Duck, Goofy, and Pluto. Designed to delight fans at home and honor the men overseas. Promoted as a love story,
Walt Disney, the world's greatest storyteller, brings the world's greatest love story to the screen. Bambi.
Bambi was released on August 13, 1942, and people lined up for blocks to see the new Disney animated feature film, making it one of the top 10 films of the decade. In 1942, we celebrated the arrival of many men and women who have influenced our world.
Hello, my name is Andreas Deja. I've been a Disney animator for almost 25 years. One of the things I love to do here at the studio is come to the Animation Research Library, where all the artwork for the Disney animated features is stored. Here I can see the work of the masters who worked on the classic animated films, including, of course, Bambi. I'd like you to join me now on a tour of the library and take a look at the incredible artwork that still exists from the original production.
I have Doug with me here today, who is a researcher, and it's very important to have some help around here because you need somebody to show you where everything is. So Doug, tell me, I'm looking for some sort of hidden treasures from Bambi. Do you know if you guys have any artwork that might not have been used in the actual movie?
Sure, let's take a look at a couple of these. Here are the story sketches
So these are actual sketches that were not used for the final film?
That's correct, yeah. They were trying to do a lot of work with a chipmunk and a squirrel, and this is one of the gags that they were working on here.
Uh-huh. And so this is the owl listening to them, right?
Mm-hmm.
There's something going on down here. And the owl flies down to find out what the racket is all about. And as the owl lands.
And it looks like it upsets their balance a bit, and they're holding.
It would have to. They're barely hanging on, now to the owl's tail over here. And this seems to be a particular artist's idea, because it says Ralph Wright's idea. So he obviously felt kind of proud of this gag. Then the branch gives and cracks. Everybody's gone, and the camera picks him up down in the snow again. Guilty expressions here on those two. You know.
Well, it looks like they had an audience.
Which happened to be Bambi and the rabbits. So I would say that they probably cut this because in developing the squirrel and the chipmunk, you know, you probably focus on too many characters. And the main story really is about Bambi, Thumper, and the skunk.
You might find this interesting, Andreas. Bees, which we don't see in the final version of the film.
I don't recall any bees in the movie, but I do remember they were working on a sequence between Bambi and a bee where one of the bees was flying to Bambi's ear and ended up in Bambi's stomach. So these might be those bees, actually. But here they're just zipping through and flying along and don't look too friendly, actually. I just can't believe how rendered these are. These would have taken so much time to capture the whole mood, I guess, of the sequence.
Another story element that didn't make the final version of the film.
The grasshoppers. And he even talks to Bambi. He says, "You up there, you almost stepped on me." And then he's actually yelling at Thumper, too. So he must have been part of the sequence as well. And I can't believe how close Thumper here looks like he does in the final film.
He's not even called Thumper. I think he's called Bobo.
Bobo?
Yeah.
Okay. Bobo the rabbit. So when I come to the Animation Research Library to do my research, this is how it works. I come into this reading room, and then people like Vivian, who is a researcher over here, will bring me the artwork to study. So what you got, Vivian?
I've got some stray sketches and visual development. So this packet is about the forest, and it has a lot of watercolor and pastel pieces, some of which are of Taiwan.
And look how small they are. He can set a mood and atmosphere very, very quickly. You know, he doesn't have to do a big painting. And these are also from the sequence that shows the forest after the fire. You can still see some glow and some ashes. And this kind of artwork was done to inspire the background painters. They took the color use from work like this and then made these into big paintings.
Yeah, one up here.
So this is a story sketch, and it's really unusual because when you look at this peculiar shadow over here, this is supposed to be man. I mean, you think of Bambi, they only talk about man. Then you never really see a human figure.
That's right.
So at one point, they were actually thinking about showing man, like in the story sketch over here. So here we are having several versions of the character of Bambi and his mother. And you can see what the animators and the character designers go through, striving to achieve a final style. And they usually start out with realism. Yeah. When you look at this drawing over here, that looks like a rendering of a real deer. There's no caricature there. And the other one that looks real, I think, is this one. Even though it's a line drawing, it kind of has sort of the realism of a real deer. And the same one over here. We're trying to find the pattern for Bambi's spots, and something like this would be way too complicated. This one even still has too much detail. It's a little simpler than some of these, but all these different color separations would also be very difficult to animate. And they're still not humanized yet. They don't have the human emotions. But these Mark Davis sketches then gave sort of the human element to it by putting human expressions onto the animal face. You can see that these eyes had gotten larger than real deer eyes. And the forehead is very big, the eyelashes. Those are all elements that you find in children. And then the stuff comes to life, and then you can say, well, these drawings could talk. So here we are looking at some background art, and this is Anne, who's going to show us some original background from the movie Bambi.
Andreas, we've picked out a few backgrounds for you.
Oh my, look at this one. What really amazes me about this one is how long it is. It would have to be a camera move. So in other words, the camera, if it would start over here, would then move all the way across here, and you might have some birds or squirrels moving through. The thing about Bambi is that the background art is very unique. There's so much left out. It's very impressionistic. And then you have these wonderful accents right here where you have a spot of light and you can see detailed bark. And I would think that we would probably have a character ending up at this spot. So these two backgrounds here are from the fire sequence. You can see that this is all painted in red tones, and it's kept, again, so simple. So what you would have in the final film is the simplicity of this background, and then the animation of the flames going across here, flickering away. It almost looks Chinese, because the Tyrus Wong brought that influence to this movie. So Anne is going to show us some backgrounds that are actually painted on glass.
Yep.
And look at these beautiful pieces of art. And I believe, again, this is from the opening shot where we truck through the forest and we pass by this little lake. And the reason why there are holes in here, and this is not painted, because this is part of a multiplane setup. In other words, there was another layer probably behind this that showed an even deeper, lower background. Look at those colors.
Beautiful.
This must be springtime. I think this is the beginning of the spring sequence. And here again, that hole over here represents the water coming through, because that would be on a different level. Some birds would fly through. That's why this is so long, because it's a pan background. But look at these impressionistic trees. I mean, just blotches of paint. And yet it all works. And we have Fox over here, who said earlier on he found something very unique.
Hello, Andres. How are you?
Good. How are you?
All righty. This is actual Bambi animation that's out of picture of the
so
character
of Bambi.
So it means
that this scene is not in the movie?
Correct.
This was cut?
Correct.
All right. Let's take a peek. Thank you. And I'm going to put these drawings onto this old peg bar, and then I can flip them back and forth, and we can see some movement. As I'm flipping it and going back and forth, you can see that Bambi is sort of startled. He's looking at something here, and something startled him, and he moves backward. And there are so many subtleties happening here. You can see how, as his head is going up, his ears are going down, and we call that counter movement. For a scene such as this, you would really have to do 24 drawings for each second. And you can see how much detail is involved. Even the spots that are drawn on Bambi have this perspective change. You can see this right away as they're going back behind him and then surfacing again on his rear. There's so much attention to detail. There's probably more detail in Bambi, I would say, than in any other Disney film. Bambi is really more than a movie. It's a work of art. And the more you know about it, the more you will enjoy it.